surface marking, abdomen and pelvis. Before moving to the subject proper, let's see some important surface bony landmarks of this region. In the upper part on either side, you can see the costal margin. It is usually visible through the skin and it is formed by the union of upturned ends of the cartilages of 9th, 10th, 8th and 7th ribs. And in the midline, the two costal margins enclose the infrasternal angle or subcostal angle. And the point 1 represents the xiphoid process, which lies in the shallow depression of infrasternal angle. And the xiphisternal joint is represented by a transverse ridge at the apex of infrasternal angle. And below, you can see the pubic symphysis seen in the median plane, and it is felt indistinct. And just lateral to pubic symphysis, there is a pubic crest which represents the free rounded upper border of body of pubis, and lateral to pubic crest is the rounded projection of pubic tubercle, and the 7 represents the anterior superior iliac spine, which is a rounded projection at the lateral end of fold of groin, and above that it is the tubercle of iliac crest, that is the 6 represents the tubercle of iliac crest, which lies 5 cm or behind the anterior superior iliac spine, which corresponds to a level of upper border of L5 vertebra. And in the midline, there is a linear depression that is known as linea alba, and there is a curved groove crossing the costal margin near the tip of the 9th costal cartilage above to the pubic tubercle, that is the linea semilunaris, which corresponds to the outer border of rectus abdominis muscle. This is another picture showing the median linear depression of linea alba and a curved groove crossing the costal margin to the pubic tubercle, representing the linea semilunaris. Coming to the planes of abdomen, there are 4 transverse or horizontal planes of abdomen and 2 vertical planes. The first horizontal plane is the transpyloric plane of Addison, which lies in the midway between the suprasternal notch and pubic symphysis, and it roughly corresponds to the midway between umbilicus and xiphisternal joint, and it crosses the tip of 9th costal cartilage, as you can see in the diagram, and it lies at the lower border of L1. Since this plane passes through the pylorus of stomach, at the level of pylorus of stomach, this is known as transpyloric plane. Next is the subcostal plane, and which is drawn below the 10th rib and corresponds to the upper border of L3 vertebra. Below that is the supracrestal plane, which is the line joining the highest point of iliac crest, which is felt at the back, and it corresponds to the L4 vertebra. And this plane is useful in counting lower vertebral spines, particularly while doing lumbar puncture. Below that is the transtubercular plane or intertubercular plane, which lies at the level of tubercle of iliac crest, which corresponds to upper border of L5 vertebra. Next is the vertical planes. First is median vertical plane, lies in the midline from pubic symphysis to the midpoint of suprasternal notch. Next is right and left lateral vertical planes. It extends from the midway between the anterior superior iliac spine and pubic symphysis, that is the mid inguinal point, to a point on the clavicle between midway between suprasternal notch and acromioclavicular joint. In other words, it is a line joining the mid inguinal point or to the mid clavicular point. I mean the whole planes, the Transpyloric plane of Addison is very important because many structures lie at this level of transpyloric plane, and the structures are the pylorus of stomach, fundus of gallbladder, anterior end of spleen, origin of superior mesenteric artery, hilum of both kidneys, neck of pancreas, origin of portal vein, and lower end of spinal cord. Moving to the abdominal region, abdomen is divided into quadrants by a median vertical plane and a transumbilical pain plane passing through the umbilicus into right and left upper quadrant and left right and left lower quadrant. And the region of abdomen is again divided into 9 regions or 3 zones by 2 horizontal and 2 vertical planes. The horizontal planes are transpyloric and transtubercular plane, and the vertical planes are right and left lateral vertical plane. The upper zone consists of right and left hypochondriac region on either side and epigastric region on the midline. And the middle zone consists of right and left lumbar region on either side and umbilicus in the center. And the lower zone consists of right and left iliac region on either side and hypogastric in the middle. Boundaries of abdominopelvic cavity. The anterior wall of abdominopelvic cavity extends from the costal margin and xiphoid process above to pubic symphysis, pubic crest, pubic tubercle, inguinal ligament, and anterior superior iliac spine below. Posterior wall is formed by the lumbar vertebra, diaphragmatic crura, psoas major, and quadratus lumborum muscles. Superiorly by the diaphragm and inferiorly by the pelvic diaphragm. Now coming to the subject proper, surface marking of deep inguinal ring. It lies 1.25 cm above the midpoint of anterior superior iliac spine and upper end of pubic symphysis. Superficial inguinal ring lies 1 cm above and lateral to pubic tubercle. And as you can see here, the dotted green line denotes the inguinal canal, which is drawn by two parallel lines joining the superficial inguinal ring and the deep inguinal ring, and it is 4 cm long, and the two parallel lines are 1 cm apart. McPhoney's point, it lies at the junction of outer and middle third of a line from right anterior superior iliac spine to umbilicus, or junction of medial two-third and lateral one-third of line joining right anterior superior iliac spine to the umbilicus, that is known as spino-umbilical line. And the clinical importance is that it is a seat of maximum pain in palpation in acute appendicitis. And the point to be noted that the surface marking of cecal orifice of appendix does not correspond to this McBurney's point. It is different. We will see it later. Coming to the stomach, first let's see the cardiac orifice. Cardiac orifice, first you have to put a point on the left 7th costal cartilage, 2.5 cm from the median plane, and then draw two parallel lines 2 cm apart, directing downwards and to the left. This represents the cardiac orifice of stomach. Move to pyloric orifice. First, you have to draw a transpyloric line. Then put a point on this line about 1.2 cm to the right of the median plane. Like that of cardiac orifice, pyloric orifice is represented by two parallel lines 2 cm apart from this point, inclining upward and to the right. And the picture depicting the cardiac orifice, that cardiac orifice lies on the left 7th costal cartilage 2.5 cm from the median plane, whereas pyloric orifice lies on a point on the transpyloric plane 1.2 cm to the right of the median plane. Next, we will see the lesser curvature, and it is represented by a J-shaped line which extends from the right margin of the cardiac orifice to the left margin of pyloric orifice. Moving on to greater curvature, for that you have to draw a subcostal plane and mark out the following points. First point is the point on the left 5th intercostal space below and medial to the left nipple, and second is a point at the junction of tips between the left 9th and 10th costal cartilage. So the greater curvature is represented by a continuous curve line which begins from the left margin of the cardiac orifice and at first arches upward and to the left, the summit of which passes through the point of apex bead. This part of convex curve above an imaginary horizontal plane extending from the cardiac orifice forms a fundus of stomach. And the greater curvature then sweeps from the left end of the fundus downwards and to right through the junction between the tips of left 9th and left 10th costal cartilages, reaches the subcostal plane and ends by joining the lower margin of pyloric orifice. This is coming to duodenum. It has a first part, second part, third and fourth part. Let's see. It is a point on the transpyloric line. Point on the transpyloric line 1.2 cm to the right of the median plane, that represents the pyloric orifice. And the second point, 2.5 cm above and 2.5 cm to the right of the pyloric orifice. Now join these two lines by two parallel lines 2.5 cm wide, which represents the first part, which is directed upwards and to the right. And for the second part of duodenum, take a point 7.5 cm below the second point, that is the where the first part ends, which lies medial to the right lateral plane. So the second part is represented by two parallel lines 2.5 cm wide, which extends downwards, joining these two lines. And third part, for that put a point in the median plane at the level of third point. Now join this third and fourth points by two parallel lines 2.5 cm apart, which extend horizontally towards the midline and lie above the umbilicus. And the fourth part of the duodenum, take a point 2.5 cm to the left of the median plane and 1 cm below the transpyloric plane. Third part with the duodenojejunal flexure. Coming to the ileocecal orifice, you can clearly see in the diagram the ileocecal orifice lies at the intersection of transtubercular plane and the right lateral vertical plane. Whereas the base of vermiform appendix or the orifice of vermiform appendix lies 2 cm below the intersection point of transtubercular and right lateral planes. Liver, it has upper border, right border and lower border. Let's see the first diagram for the upper border. For the upper border of liver, first take a point slightly below the right nipple on the fifth rib. Second, a point at the siphes sternal joint. Third, a point little below and medial to left nipple in the left to fifth intercostal space. And join these three lines by a concavo-convex line so that the summit of right convexity is slightly higher than that of the left. For the lower border, see the second diagram. First, see the from below upwards. First, take a point 1 cm below the tip of right 10th costal cartilage. Second is a point opposite to the tip of right 9th costal cartilage. Third point is a point in the midline on transpyloric plane. And fourth point is the point slightly below and medial to left nipple. And join these points by a line which slopes downwards and to the right from the last point to the first point. And this border presents a slight notch opposite to the tip of right 9th costal cartilage for the fundus of gallbladder. Now for the right borders, and it is represented by a curved line convex to the right from the right end of upper border to the right end of lower border. Fundus of gallbladder seen in an angle between right costal cartilage and linea semilunaris, and it is represented by the point just below the tip of right 9th costal cartilage. There is an important sign related to it, that is Murphy's sign related to this region. It's a classical sign in patient with cholecystitis. It is elicited by asking the patient to breathe deeply while exerting moderate pressure on this region using thumb of examiner. And if the gallbladder is inflamed, the patient catches his breath since the inflamed gallbladder is pushed down by the diaphragm, gets embossed against the thumb. This sign is known as Murphy's sign or Moynihan's mother. This is elicited at this region by exerting pressure, moderate pressure. Root of mesentery, represented by this red line, is a line joining the two points. The first point is that point 2.5 cm to the left of the median midline and 1 cm below the transpyloric plane. This point corresponds to duodeno-jejunal flexure. And the second point is the point at the intersection between the transtubercular and right lateral plane that represents the ileocecal junction. And join these points by an oblique line extending downwards and to the right, which represents the root of mesentery. Spleen. First, take a point 4 cm to the left of the median plane at the level of 10th thoracic spine, which corresponds to the medial end of spleen. The second point is on the left 10th rib in mid-axillary line that represents the center of lateral end of spleen. And in between these two points, mark out left 9th and 11th rib. Now join these points by an ovoid outline which overlaps 9th to 11th ribs. And the left 10th rib represents the axis of spleen. Now coming to the relations of kidney to the vertebrae and ribs. Left kidney is related to 11th and 12th rib on its posterior surface, whereas right kidney is related to 12th rib on its posterior surface. And the upper end of kidneys corresponds to
T12 level, and the hilum or the medial border is corresponds to the lower border of L1 vertebra, and the lower pole is related to L3 vertebra, which is slightly different for left kidney. Let's see each.
Surface marking of kidneys from front, that is anterior surface marking. For that we will take 4 points. First point is the point 5 cm lateral to the midline on transpyloric plane, which represents the position of hilum. Next, draw a curved line 2.5 cm long with medial concavity from the first point. For the right kidney, the line extends downwards, and for the left kidney, it extends upwards. And the second point, 0.4 cm above the upper end of curved line, 2.5 cm from the median plane. Third point is a 0.4 cm below the lower end of curved line, which is 7.5 cm from the median plane. Now fourth point is the point on the transpyloric plane 5 cm lateral to the first point. Now join the hilar concavity with adjacent second and third points by lines with convexity directed medially, and finally join the second and third points by a line with outward convexity which passes through the fourth point. While drawing this two kidneys, the upper ends should be drawn nearer to the median plane than the lower ends, and the outline of both kidneys are projection when projected. The left kidney should be slightly higher than the right one. Coming to the posterior surface marking of kidney, for that draw two horizontal lines passing through T11 and L3 spines, and two vertical lines 2.5 cm and 9 cm from the median plane, thus enclosing a area known as Morris parallelogram or parallelogram of Morris. Within the parallelogram, draw the outline of kidney so that upper end is nearer to the median plane than the lower end, and the position of right kidney is slightly lower than the left one. And the points to note that the upper end lies at a point 2.5 cm from the lateral from the midline, and the hilar lies 5 cm from the midline, and the lower end lies 7.5 cm from the midline. Renal angle is the angulation between the lower border of 12th rib and the lateral border of erector spinae muscle. Here, the posterior surface of lower part of kidney can be seen, and it lies beneath the renal angle, and it is not engrossed by any costo-diaphragmatic recess of pleura. So, surgically, the kidney is exposed retroperitoneally by an oblique incision which extends downwards and forwards starting from renal angle. And also the renal tenderness or renal colic pain shoots downwards and forwards from the renal angle to the groin. So renal angle is also very important. So another picture showing the position of right and left kidney. Now coming to the surface marking of ureter from front. For that, first you have to draw the hilar concavity of each kidney from a point on the transpyloric plane 5 cm lateral to the median plane. Then take a point 5 cm below the transpyloric plane and 5 cm lateral to the median plane. That is the second point. Third point is at the junction of upper one-third and lower two-third of a line drawn from a point 1.2 centimeter below and to the left of the umbilicus to the mid-inguinal point. That point corresponds to the point of bifurcation of common iliac artery. And the fourth point is at the point on the pubic tubercle. And the line joining the first and second points represent the funnel-shaped outline of pelvis of ureter, whereas the second and third points joining line represents the abdominal part of ureter, which is a very important surface marking, abdominal part of ureter. And the rest of the line extending from the third to fourth point represents the pelvic part of ureter. And the surface marking your ureter from back. For that, you have to take a point 4 cm from the median plane at the lower level of first lumbar spine. That is 4 cm from median plane at the on the transpyloric plane. And another point over a dimple which overlies the posterior superior iliac spine. And line joining these points represents the ureters from back. Now coming to the arteries and veins of abdomen and pelvis. First let's see the abdominal aorta. You can clearly see the abdominal aorta. It extends from T12 to L4 vertebra. For that, take a point in the median plane 2.5 cm above the transpyloric plane. Above the transpyloric plane, and another point 1.2 cm below and 1.2 cm to the left of the umbilicus. Now draw two parallel lines 2 cm apart connecting these two points, which represents the abdominal aorta. This celiac trunk. Here is a celiac trunk, and it is represented by a small circle in the median plane 2.5 cm above the transpyloric plane. Coming to inferior vena cava. First point is a point just below the transtubercular plane and 2.5 cm to the right of the median plane. That is a point below the transtubercular plane and 2.5 cm to the right of the median plane. Second point is point at the sternal end of right 6th costal cartilage. And now draw two parallel vertical lines 2.5 cm apart connecting these two points, which represents the inferior vena cava. Thank you.